Well, hello, it's Thomas here, and we are about to get busy. But until we get properly started, let me switch the view. Just solve a couple of puzzles. Just make sure that everything works as it should. Hey, Jayla. Hey, no accident. It was just the window on the driver's side. It suddenly refused to go back up, so I had to put it in repairs to have that fixed because I don't have the correct tools to make it happen. Unfortunately, let me okay, that was it. Fix this a little bit here. Yeah, this is better. Yeah, much less dangerous, but a lot more annoying. A lot more annoying. Because I had to drive with a plastic tarp in front of outside my window, tape it stuck, and it didn't really want to stay in place. And then, of course, eventually I had to more or less just live with it until I was there. It's been like this since last week, but they didn't have time for me in the garage until today or tomorrow, so I had to drive up there and deliver the car early. Yeah, okay, let's take a look at the next one. This looks pretty easy. I could, of course, check here, but then he just blocks me. And of course, I can just take this. He takes the pawn, I grab this, but then he has a rather dangerous attack against me. Nah, not so very cold, it's about -4, -5. Nothing too bad. It was only -2.5 when I drove up towards the garage. And I just had the AC just going full pelt. Okay, but I could go check here. If he blocks, then I swing over here with a check. And then he can't attack my queen again. So this and this. And then we grab this. So we have a queen for a bishop and knight and a completely winning position. Okay, so he might be thinking about popping in there to stop me from getting onto this diagonal with my king. So I could check him here, but he can go there. I can't do this because then he sneaks in behind everything. Hey, Peter, welcome, man. So, Moobot is awake. I hope Nightbot is awake. We'll find out soon enough. Let's just check with one command. Yeah. And guess who got quoted? Yeah, I want to wait for a few more viewers before I start going over the OTB game. Yeah, kind of a conspiracy, can we say? Yeah. Maybe I should get a cup of coffee. Yeah, I mean, we quote each other all the time. Nothing wrong with that. So basically what I want to do is move my king here to hit this one. And then push this. But he has this move, so do I push the pawn first, but then he goes there, and I can check him and kick him out. So I think that is probably the best move. Kick, then here. No, he can't go there. Well, that was, well, I can go there. And no need to give up the pawn. OTB, yeah, over the board, indeed. That is basically when you have a proper chess board and pieces and everything, and you just play and hope for the best. But since I have you here, Chayla, I think we should maybe go into your game as a first. So you start with e4, as I have taught you. And when you see this, always, you always take. Because the way you played this, yeah, there was a lot of mistakes. I just went through it really quickly and I could count a whole lot. Your opponent will always take this. This is a so-called Tennyson gambit. And if you want to play that gambit, which can be really sharp, you need to take your knight out there and hit it. Your opponent will probably do something like this to defend, and then you go there. And he might do something like this, and then you do this. So there are many pieces attacking this pawn, and he has no more defenders coming to it. The queen can't get there unless he goes there. And you can even ignore and just go there first, threatening this pawn, force him to do this, and then you go here. And eventually you will win this pawn. There is no way around it. Because even if he tries to dive the queen up there, it's only going to be painful. Because then you can just go out there. So, like, if he goes like this, what's he going to do? And in this position, I mean, your opponent is really just struggling to get his pieces out in this position. And that is basically what you want to do. And you can do all kinds of nasty shit here in this position. And basically what you want to do is just, after he moves, you go out, let him take, he takes back, you take back, and then your bishop is willing to come out to put more pressure on this pawn. So it's all going to be bad, but you made a horrible move there, this, basically giving him a piece for nothing. And that was not what you're supposed to do. Absolutely not. A better move would have been bishop to b5, check. And if he goes here, then you're in trouble anyway. Yeah. But the thing is, if he takes the pawn like this, you need to get the knight out of dodge. So, this is the move, always. But like we said, this is what happened. F6 is a terrible move. He's probably trying to stop you from putting your knight there. And you made a decent move, castling in immediately. E5. Yeah, basically what you want to do here, put the queen up there. Tie down this bishop to this pawn. Because you are a piece down and you want to get your pieces out as quickly as possible. So this guy wants to come out to there. And then you want to move this pawn, trade, and then move this pawn so this guy can get out. And then you can move the rooks. Yeah, we're not too worried about this bishop here because you just sack a pawn and let's see, if you would play the pawn here and he goes there, you don't worry. There's nothing to worry about. You just drop him down there and then push the other pawn. Yeah, that's what happens when you give up a piece, then you have all kinds of trouble. But yeah, you did this. And this is not a good move either. Absolutely not. Push the pawn. He can't take, and he can't take. But you will just take it here. Because if he pushes, then you take with the rook, with a check. And then you can push this pawn and the bishop comes out. Yeah. Taking this pawn with a knight is just a really bad move. You're basically down two pieces for two pawns. And this is no good. And this queen h5 move, unnecessary. Much better this. Yeah, we play a different game together on the mobile. And with the knight, with the queen here, you are hitting this rook, and basically all he can do to defend it is push the pawn. And that's okay. You don't have to worry about that. Because now you can do this and this. And this. Yeah, you completely fell off the rails there. But yeah, you played queen h5 with a check. And this, I mean, going there was not a good move either. Back off to here. Because now you're threatening to dive up there again. Hitting the other rook. And basically what you would do is go there and then you again push and bishop here. And you're defending this pawn. But you went there, and basically what your opponent could have done was just grab this. But he didn't. And again, d4, a horrible move. Back off down here. Defend the pawn, and keep this guy just pinned. As long as he stays pinned to the king, your king has no easy way to get away, and everything is just decent. This doesn't work because you just take it. You could do this, but then you just go there. Again, hitting the rook. So d4 was just a terrible move, but your opponent just didn't see it as such. And in this position, play this. Bishop is suddenly open, or you could take him to here. Just strengthen your center. Even if he takes this, you take back. He can do this, but then you go here. And you are defending this square, and then you can take out the bishop, and your rook defends the back rank. And he can't go there to threaten this either. So all your pieces are defending everything. But yeah. Knight c3. Not an abysmal move by any stretch of the imagination. And this h6 move. Yeah, again. Back off the queen here. Increase the pressure on the knight. And if he goes there, just back off here. There was no need to hunt down this guy. Just move the queen out of the way. Hey Gina, welcome. So this was, and this, absolutely unnecessary. When you're down so much material, never ever trade the queens. Well, this is not my game. This is Mantarium, aka Jayla, playing against someone online. So, you did get this rook for free though. Yeah, again, push the pawn here. Don't think about this pawn. You want your bishop out so your rook defends your back rank. Yeah, but still, down a bishop. Yeah, bishop takes h6 as well. Threatening all kinds of nasty stuff here. And white would need to do, black would need to do something like this, queen e7. And yeah, white is not too bad there. So, knight there, queen d5, hitting this guy, c6, and this was so unnecessary, you just basically gave the game away there. Just back off, keep this guy pinned. Keep him pinned. You don't want to give up your queen for a lousy bishop. Yeah, this was absolutely the misplay. As long as you can keep this guy pinned, even if he moves his bishop here, you just back off again. Keep him pinned. And then you can take this guy out, rook out, and that makes those guys pretty stuck where they are. But you basically just gave the game away there, and from that point there is basically no need to analyze much. Yeah. And in this position, back off the bishop down here. Defend this square. But you went down here, wrong side, and give up the mate. You are very passive in this game, and yeah. Playing aggressive is about you need to start by developing your pieces before you start attacking. That is the number one thing. And basically, what I taught you about the Italian game, very often you will see this happen here in the Italian game. And there is a nasty little thing here. You sacrifice a pawn on the wing, and he can go there or there, doesn't matter which way, and you go there. And basically what you're doing is you're grabbing the center, though you don't do this straight away, because you need to somehow try to kick this guy out of this. But you just castle, and then just get ready to just steamroller him. So that's basically what needs to happen. Yeah, it was always a hard thing to return from. Yeah, developing with threats is always better. But like I said, playing the Italian game for a beginner is usually a very easy thing to play. So just... But this is the key position for the Italian game. If he plays anything else, like if he does this, take it without thinking twice. If he plays c5, knight f3, and then you follow it up with c3 and d4. Or you can do c3 immediately. Yeah, you just need to practice it. That's all there is. And I've seen people try with this, then you just push this guy. This and this. It's always about defending your central pieces when people play those offbeat openings. But the usual standard things you see against this, you might see the French defense. And then you just go d5 against the Caro Kann, d5. The Ruy Lopez is far from simpler. I have been looking at that, and the Italian game is much easier, at least for beginners. You are much more advanced than they are, so the Ruy Lopez maybe becomes a little bit simpler, but I hate the Ruy Lopez. I never play it. That's why I go into the Scots game or Danish Gambit or any of those crazy lines, even the King's Gambit. I just hate the Ruy Lopez. It's the most annoying opening in the world because of the bloody Berlin defense. That is something I absolutely detest. Yeah, I can't be patient. That's not my style. Okay, and that brings us nicely to my game. My opponent, his highest rating that I could find was something near 1850 FIDE. And so he is a good player. He's just a bit out of practice, but he played a defense that I usually struggle against. And I think you may know what that is, Gina. Yeah, you're welcome. You're welcome. So as usual, I start e4. He starts c6, d4, d5. This is the Caro Kann, which is usually my nemesis. Yeah, I'm white. And so we go down the Panov attack route. This is your standard theory there. And he goes for this setup, e6, knight f3, knight c6. And basically, my failure in this particular setup is that I tend to drive my bishop up to g5, which isn't really the best. Yeah, but he just wanted to play solid. That was all he was thinking about. And see if I would make mistakes. I was pondering to play the advanced, but I don't really know much theory there. I know a little bit more here. And basically, what I should do here is just play h3. Immediately just take away this jump. And then develop my bishop. c5, yeah, maybe. And I kind of like leaving my bishop behind for a while, see if my opponent takes here so I can develop to c4 in one fell swoop. Yeah, but I have never really found any working continuation when I play c5. It's very difficult for me. c5 basically limits this bishop to only going to e7. He has no prospects going further up on the board. So playing this move here, he only has this for this bishop. And then I can do something like this and follow up here and here. But as soon as this pawn comes up, he will just push this. Or after a3, he goes here. So, yeah, as soon as a3 comes, he will go for a4 immediately. Not really. It's just a matter of knowing the lines. Basically, what black wants to do in this opening when you're getting there is just to get developed and then make his break on the queen side. That's usually the play for black in the Caro Kann, especially after the trade here and the pawns being lined up like this. Then it's a question of attacking the queen side. But I played bishop to g5. Yeah, I know. But that was basically my thought. To maybe go for this. And but he will play a4 as soon as I play a3. My opponent, he played bishop e7, and this is where I made my first what I feel was a mistake. I traded off my dark square bishop. Yeah, but I have to basically study the Panov in much more detail. Yeah, the thing is, you have to look at the way you line up your pawns. I mean, if your pawns inhibit this guy's development, then you should basically go for a queenside attack, more or less. And this trade here turned out to give me a very hard position for the rest of the game. Yeah, so I decided to trade on d5, and then bishop e2. I don't know if bishop b5 would have been better, going down there instead. See if I could get him to chase me here. And then just back down to this to create some kind of an attacking thing. Yeah, bishop d3 maybe. But then of course he has this pawn. He can grab it whenever. And he would probably take it with a bishop. If I take back, he take with a knight, and then I can't check him. And I wouldn't really want to give up the pawn like that. And just having a quick look at what the engine wants to do in this position. Yeah, the engine wants bishop b5 or bishop e2. Either of the two, or h3. And yeah, they are equal really. Bishop e2 or bishop b5. They are equal. But black has a slight advantage now. Better developed and all of that. Since I wasted a move on the trade here on f6. So I decided just to play bishop b2 and just get castled. So we both did that. And then he played bishop e6, basically fortifying this pawn. Yeah, black is a little bit better there. About a half a pawn, maybe 0.7. And yeah, rook c1. Yeah, I was always expecting queen b6, but he never played it. He came up to rook c8. Seems like he is a pretty experienced Caro Kann player, so he knows the lines pretty well. He has been playing it for a very long time. Because last time I played him, he played the Scandinavian with move 3, queen d6. The thing that Magnus Carlsen made pretty popular. And I destroyed him in that line. So he probably didn't want to repeat that. So queen d2, and again I thought, fuck, I'm making all kinds of mistakes in this position. Basically what I was thinking was, if he would go there, then I could slide my rook to d1 to defend this pawn three ways. Yeah, moving the same piece a lot is not very good in the opening. I was really just breaking all the opening principles here, because I was in a position I've never seen before, and it basically just threw me off. So he decided to go for queen d6. No, I'm doing over the board analysis right now. So no challenges. And welcome to the stream. So I played h3 just to make sure that he wouldn't sneak in there. And he just played h6. And now I thought I would try something that might actually work, but I missed one move out of all of that calculation. I played rook to f2 e1 first. My idea was to drop my bishop here and eventually go for something like this. But he kept putting on pressure. So I decided, well, let's see what happens. I didn't want to risk his access to this square, and this thing will be dead. So he played rook e7, and then I decided to play a move I regret in hindsight. I played knight to b5, basically just trying to create some kind of an alignment issue for his queen and pawn. But he found the best move, I think, queen b8. And then I dropped my bishop to f1, just making sure that he had no sacrifices on h3, without me having at least bishop g2 to defend. And then he brought in this move, and that surprised me quite a lot. I was not expecting that. I have to admit, I did not expect this move. So, yeah, I decided to trade the rooks. And I think in hindsight, maybe I should have played rook to c1. Basically just try to force the rook trade. At least try to contest the file. And his moving there is no good, because I would just trade without thinking twice about it. And if he tried to go for this, I would just trade like this and go here. And this is a much easier position to play for white, I think. But I played knight to c1. No, knight to c3, I mean, just going back to this plan. And he went back to d6. Hey! Thank you for the raid. Well, welcome, guys. I'm rolling through my OTB game from last night. And yeah, as you can see, I am not in a very good shape as white. Hello, Will. Welcome, man. Yeah, thank you, man. Thank you. Yeah, so I decided to go for a3 here. Just keep that file closed for now. My opponent played knight c6. And maybe here I should have gone for the immediate knight e2. Ah, thank you for the beard comment, and welcome to the chat. Hey, Sir Bates. Welcome, buddy. But of course, I chose kind of a slower thing. Yeah, thank you for the follow, man. Yeah, I was kind of expecting that. I was kind of expecting queen b6. But if he had played queen b6 here, I'm not quite sure what I would have played, actually. Probably knight to e2, adding an extra defender, and even if he dives down here, then I can go here. Or even just here. putting some pressure on the file. But he came up with this, and hey, Jon. Welcome, man. So, I played b4, just trying to steal some space and just stop him from any kind of knight a5. Yeah, maybe it was. But, yeah, this is how it went. And he backed off again. And I played knight e2. He played bishop to e4, which was a big surprise for me. I had no idea what he was planning there, other than maybe just to trade this thing. And I think I should have played knight to g3 immediately here. Just close this diagonal. In hindsight, that's what I should have done. But I went too passive. Knight h2. I was basically thinking about going out here to get rid of this guy, because he was causing me trouble. Hey, Big E, welcome, man. Welcome, buddy. And McDonkadonk, welcome as well. And thank you for the raid, Big E. Two raids in a matter of 3 minutes. That's very nice. Thank you, guys. And thank you for the follow, McDonkadonk. Yeah, my opponent, he went for this nasty little bishop to g5 hit, and this is basically where I blundered the game away, unfortunately. I thought I had a good response to this move, but it turned out that it was much worse than I expected, because I missed one in-betweener. And my failure was to recognize that f5 was absolutely undefended. So I played f4, and this is basically my only blunder of the game. I had four inaccuracies which were less detrimental to my position, and he followed it up. I was expecting this move, and I thought I had a good answer to that. And I thought my good answer would be the move I played, queen e3. And I had completely missed this move. And now I am in such a pickle that if I try to go down there, he just chases me. And I have really nothing to show for what I'm doing. And in this position, basically, the game is more or less lost, because he has all the pressure. So I decided to try to move over to b3 and try to put some pressure on this guy. So he just took this pawn. And this trade turned out to be a poor choice, because I missed a very important move that he had. I missed a very important move. Yeah, I'm just in a heap of trouble here. I missed this move. And I only had two moves that I thought about in this position. Rook d2 or rook e1. Both are bad. That's the big problem. both are really bad. And the big problem is that if I play rook e1, he can just take there. If I take back, queen there, and it's an immediate checkmate. There is no defense. So I decided to try rook d2, but I missed his response, which was as simple as they come. Rook to c1. Basically a threat of a checkmate in one. And after this, he just kept pressing. Just kept pressuring me. I tried to defend, and I missed another resource that he had that completely killed me there. Bishop takes f3. And the big problem is, if I take, he takes. This is the only move. Check. Checkmate. So, I couldn't do that. So my only move, bishop b2. And of course, he found the best move. Knight takes f1. And again, if I try to take this, he jumps out here with this, and or out here. And it's again, a pretty quick checkmate. So I tried grabbing with rook, and he checked me on e3. Again, I missed this resource. So all I could do was block with the queen. He took, I took, he took, I took back. He backed his bishop off to e4, queen f2, g5, and this is where I threw in the towel. Stone dead. Hey, Indo queen, welcome, darling. I just have to learn the theory better. Or maybe try for something else. Yeah, it's okay. I was playing over the board last night and I got my ass handed to me. As simple as it is. I have been thinking about maybe trying to look into the fantasy variation of you mean in this position here? If I take this, he just takes here. And if I take here, he just checks. I go back and he backs out, and this is just dead winning. Yeah, the fantasy variation of the Caro. If I remember it correctly, it's f3 here. And it's an extremely sharp variation. And basically, this is what we want to do. Yeah, queen b6 is a pretty annoying move to deal with. But of course, this is what we have to do. Just develop fast, get the king to everything, all the defenses, and of course we can just defend here. Yeah, This is basically the idea, get the knight to c4 to make sure that this queen can't stay there. But I had been, because I had never seen what my opponent played last night, his main repertoire. So basically, I had been well, most people I see play against the fantasy variation, they take on e4, every single one. But those who are new, are closer in the theory side of things, they probably go queen b6. I mean, queen b6 here. Yeah, and this is something I need to study, because I'm not very well versed in this particular variation. I need to learn this, learn the theory there. So I have to look it up. Or of course I could just go to my old favorite, just go for this, because this is the usual move, and just go for h4. And I have caught so many off guard playing this, and then they go down a piece immediately. So I had one stream early on in my streaming time when I played this guy in the 45 plus 45 league on Leeches, and I caught him out in this variation immediately. Because it doesn't matter where he goes, he could try this, we just chase him. And he tried going for this, but I just blocked. This is what I played against him, and he actually went for this. I did this, and he took, I took, he grabbed this, and I think I did something like this, and he, I can't remember exactly what he did there, but he at least gave up his queen. Can't remember if I took here. It was a very painful game for him indeed, and he just resigned on move like 12, something like that. Yeah, I think I will go back to the advanced variation. I think it's easier to play for me, because I'm not really good at playing with an isolated queen pawn, and it's something I have never studied really. So that's basically what I need to think of. yeah, it might actually do that. I'm thinking about maybe having a short simul then. Anybody up for that? Let's see. Okie dokie. Let's see. Depends on where, which position you get, whether you get the white or the black. I can't remember the link. Okay, no London system, thank you very much. That's only stipulation and no bullet chess. Okay. Yeah, the London system is a very annoying opening. Like I said, this is the link. I just want to feed feed the simul link into Nightbot very quickly. So, this is the link. Bullet is super fast playing to try to take advantage of me having low time and flag me. Yeah, I know Mark invented bullet. And everybody is welcome. I don't mind getting kicked in the ass really hard. Okay, so looks like Matt is there as well. Metal Eagle himself. And Gina is in there as well. Acerbait and Jayla. The time is 20 minutes, 15 seconds increment, and I have 40 minutes extra time. Focusing on night coffee? Yeah, join us, man. Join us. 20 plus 15 is not... yeah, sure, try it. Yeah, there are so many different openings. Mm-hmm. By all means, fire away. It's more fun if there are more players. And with what looks like 14 viewers in the chat, would be nice to have some more players. I'm a metalhead, but I play all kinds of stuff. I play the blues, I try playing the jazz and all kinds of stuff. Thank you. Thank you for that, Gina. Hand grinder. That could be misunderstood to a degree. Yeah, I've been listening to metal for 42 years, to be honest. I can't stop. Just too much fun. And maybe I should actually... Yeah, no, I can't be bothered. My favorite bands? Yeah, Iron Maiden will always be number one. Then, of course, Megadeth, Testament, Annihilator, Creator from Germany. Sonata Arctica. Exodus. More, yeah, Stratovarius from Finland. Nightwish, again from Finland. All kinds of, yeah, or you can just ask Nightbot to bring the link. I try to put the simul link in the bot every now and again. The Trooper, yeah, the Trooper is a nice song. I've always been into the epic songs like Rime of the Ancient Mariner or Blood Brothers, Passchendaele, Alexander the Great, all those long epic songs, Phantom of the Opera, The Clansman. Stuff like that. Yeah, Halloween are good. I like them as well. I have so many bands that I like. I can never really remember to mention everything, but there's just a lot. Yeah, I actually saw Halloween in 1988 live at the Monsters of Rock Festival at Castle Donington. And Halloween were the... Yeah, I haven't listened to the newest album either, but I will soon. I will soon, that's for sure. Yeah, Castle Donington. Sick, the Dying and the Dead. Yeah, I haven't heard more than maybe one song of it. I like what I've heard so far, so. Yeah, if I remember correctly, Halloween were the opening band, and then we had Megadeth, and then there was Guns N' Roses, and they were shite, absolutely diabolical. They were so crapped out of their heads, they could barely play. and actually two people died in the rush when people were trying to get closer to the stage. Got just trampled. And then there was David Lee Roth with Billy Sheehan on bass and Steve Vai on the guitar. And then there was Kiss, and Iron Maiden finished off the thing. Yeah, Axl Rose, he just basically ruined the band. Yeah, completely ruined the band. If I remember correctly, it was AC Stradlin who wrote more or less all of the songs. And when he was out of the band, the songs were just horrible. Yeah, looks like I'm gonna have to let's see. Okie dokie. Okay, so it's been discorded as well. I had to discord announce it as well. Yeah, no problem, man. Hey, DK guy, welcome, man. So people can actually join. I'd like to see more people popping in. No, they're kind of a tough crowd now, because I think Lance is playing one of his 5+3 simuls. But while I wait, I'm going to get a cup of coffee because my throat is dry. And maybe a glass of water as well. are. Some coffee ready and some water, and close the door. Try to avoid waking people up in the house. Yeah, I mean, he's delusional if he thinks he gets 100 players every time. Well, this is not Icelandic, actually, it's Norwegian. This is something I got from my kids as a Christmas present. Very, very nice. So, McDonkadonk and you guys, aren't you joining? Don't care your rating, guys. I learn from getting whooped. Me? I can sleep easy anytime. On the plane, on the train, on the boat, in the car if I'm a passenger, I fall asleep without a problem there. Very easy. Yeah, I can drink a full pot of coffee and I fall asleep without any trouble. Yeah, no problem, man. Yeah, well, looks like we're not going to get any more people into this, so... So a three-person simul, that should be enough. Once a week? You're not a coffee person then. Not really. Okay, DK guy is in. That's nice. That's pretty likely ass whooping I'm going to get there. Yeah, I don't depend on it at all. So, I just like the taste. So, looks like we're not going to get any more people in there, so why not just get started then? Yeah. And doesn't look like McDonkadonk is joining in either, so... Last call, guys. Last call. Yeah, DK guy is from Denmark, Mantarium is from Denmark as well. Yeah, Johnny, that's understandable. Yeah, okay, no problem, man. So let's... Bullet and London. Yeah. Okie dokie. Yeah, the Mora is on the board, of course. It's just part of the opening. Okay. Stream cutting out. Oh, that's odd. That's odd. I have nothing going but Firefox and Streamlabs. Yeah, occasionally there are ads playing and not much we can do about it. Yeah. The funny thing is, my opponent in the OTB game, he had a 10 centipawn loss. Played at 98% accuracy. Okay, so there are two moves in this position, this and this. No, he wasn't shuffling at all. Wasn't shuffling at all, and it wasn't on interactive boards. Yeah, I save them, and the VOD is usually available on Twitch afterwards. And then, of course, I load the finished product up to Dennis's server. For keepsake. Yeah, cheers, man. Feel free. So. Mm-hmm. Maybe here. I think though that this is probably my optimum setup. Yeah, I'm not too worried about C4. Seen it before many times. Let's just make sure we keep the material. Okay, it goes there. Let's just break through. Just back off here and then kick this guy. He is going to send his troops in there, maybe. Well, now he's watching DK guy. He could have many games in tabs. Okay. Just castle. Make sure everything is relatively safe. Yeah. Okay, Serpate. As usual, plays a wild game. Let's see. Okay, so who is Pump? Welcome to the stream. Planning a press of this guy forward, and this might dive in as well. My rating, 2007 in rapid chess, 1653 FIDE. Let's see. In this particular time control, I am 1892. I've gone down a bit. I was near 2000. Yeah, thank you for the follow there, Pump. So, is this going to do much? It is, of course, putting pressure on this guy. Don't really want this guy to come in, so we might try this. Let's get the king onto a dark square. Kind of fancy kicking that bishop away. Oh, runs all the way home. Let's go on the attack. My favorite opening. The Mora Gambit against Sicilian defense. So is this going to do anything? Maybe just back off here. Easy enough. Oh, he wants to meet me here. G5. Maybe just get rid of that knight there. It is quite annoying. Just take this. Yeah, I think I will. As black, I don't have many favorite openings though. Of course, there are a few that are a lot of fun. Okay, let's see how exacerbate reacts to my next little trick. Okay. Sacks a rook. Let's see how that goes. Check, check, takes, check. It goes there. I grab the rook. It comes out here. I can grab this and he can take my knight. No, he can't take my knight because the bishop is defending it. So, yeah, let's roll with it. Nah, not this. That would have been a hideous blunder. Okay, let's back off again. Takes, 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 probably takes. Ah, I forgot about my rook there. Yeah, well, shit happens. That's just the way it is. Let's grab him back. Yeah, slow is good. Indeed. Good point there, very good point. Yeah, Acer bait, had enough. Down a bishop and knight. So it's going to be a very difficult thing to survive. Yeah, he is completely out of the taxing zone, I'm afraid. No, that gives away an exchange. A pause or a rewind button in my life. Neither. Things have to roll. Do I give up the pawn? I think that might be the best thing. Let's drop down here as a start. Castle. Yeah, that was expected. So if I take, Let's see how it goes. I'm probably lost anyway. Yeah, you did. Quite a big waste. Okay, I think it's about time to go on the attack here. I am more or less dead lost in this game, but, well, what the heck. It happens. It happens. Well, this might not be such a good move. If I take... It's actually pretty nice. You might want to speed up a little bit, Jayla, because your time is running low. Yeah, that was to be expected. Pin to the checkmate, so this is a lost game. Cup is empty. Yeah, of course, and then my rook is dead. Yeah, this is probably completely dead lost as well. Thanks, TK guy. Yeah, you're too inclined to blockade, Jayla, instead of just moving the attacked pieces out of the way. Yeah, coffeehouse chess is fun. Okay, let's just keep chasing that queen. Just for the hell of it. Yeah, it's okay. I haven't really been looking much into the King's Indian, so I'm pretty happy with that. I wish I could give you a take back on this, Jella. Why are you giving away your queen for nothing? Yeah, it's pretty decent. I can't argue with that. And when you have to think about more games than one at a time, it's always kind of difficult. It's possible, very likely. I haven't really looked into this line. I have to refresh my brain a little. No, I did not have a checkmate with the bishop and knight. Well, far from it. You could have taken my bishop with your king. Yeah, you're too keen on throwing pieces to the wolves, Jella, so... Yeah. Yeah, I have to look into this line again, see what... John Bartholomew recommends. Yeah, this was to be expected. I only have this. Nothing but just trade there. Yeah, you don't need to take anything unforced. That's the thing. Often you just want to get your pieces to a good square. That's all you need to think about. Yeah, this endgame is probably lost because I'm down the exchange and a pawn. My only hope is that Gina blunders or flags. But I don't deserve to win the game, that's for sure. Yeah, see you around, Desilius. I try to avoid flagging people, but I only do it. Yeah, sure thing, man. And yeah, see you around, buddy. Only games I usually flag people is in blitz games and stuff like that. Gina. This was not deserved on my behalf. Absolutely not. Okay. I can't complain with 92% accuracy against the Scandi sort of thing. The modern variation. This h6 move is just not good. Yeah, well, it's very hard to get any play on the queen side because I'm down a pawn there. So basically what you should have done is just try to trade the pawns and that's the way it should go. Okay, Cella. in this position here, take it. Just take the pawn. The opening expects it. But instead you go for this extra aggressive expansion there on the king side. So I'm already almost two pawns to the good here. And basically from this point it was just about creating control. I could have taken en passant, but I decided it was better to take the pawn with a knight. Probably was worst a3 to kick this guy away first though. Yeah. Yeah, the engine doesn't like me, but then again, the engine is a scumbag, as you guys know. Yeah, this is a blunder. It weakens the queen side for way too much, and basically what I can do just about anything I want here. And moving this knight around so much, not so good. And yeah, in this position, still pretty even material, except that I have a pawn to the good. Queen f6, not really a good move. Rook e5 was basically just a complete crazy blunder. Yeah, indeed. The engine lines, they are just no good. Yeah, rook e5 should not have been played there. Queen to f4 would have been better because it gives you some defense. But I would probably have just played g3, just kicking the queen out. You could go there. And yeah, this guy is in a pretty bad state. So this basically gave up the game. And this was not my best move actually, I just should have taken this. Up a full piece, and then I can hit the queen here or here, depending on what I feel like. Yeah, from this point on, it was just a question of... yeah, this was not a very good move. In this position, you're better off dropping behind here. Just get your knight out of the way, and if my bishop moves, then you can get the queen. Though, if I can go here, bounce here, and even if I have the check, you can just go to the side. So yeah, trading off, and this was just again unnecessary. Just take this guy. But then of course I have this. There's three attackers on this guy, and you have this as a defense, but or I could have maybe done something even more sinister, like going here. Two pieces attacking, and if you go there, I just lift my pawn. And this guy, he can go out of the way, but I will just take the queen. Just take, you take, and then I take the rook, and everything is dead. So, yeah. So, this is where you just gave up. Yeah, you are playing 97% accuracy there, Gina. So, and by the end of the game, you are so much better. Yeah, bishop d4, even if I back down here, you have nasty stuff like this. Knight c3. Well, I can't get to knight c3. I would have to go bishop here first, and then here. But here, if I take, you take, and I go here, just go there. No, you can't. Sorry. Just check, and then go behind the pawn. I mean, I can take this pawn, but then you just grab this. Yeah, I never had knight c3, I think. You mean not here at the end? King f1, knight c3. Yeah, still, just drop the bishop there. Trade the bishops. And then rook and king against knight and pawn. This is completely winning for white. This is completely winning for white. And even if I don't take, this rook is coming up soon or going down here. So I am basically forced to give up my bishop. And then you can just move your king in at your leisure, just defending that pawn and then eventually winning the other one. Yeah, this is just completely winning for white. And basically, I don't know why the engine says c takes d5 is an inaccuracy when it drops me from down almost three pawns to plus four plus. Yeah, you need to work on that. You need to work on that. But all the way up to here. Yeah, I completely forgot about going knight c3 in this position. And castle long. Completely forgot about it. Yeah. Yeah, this transposed pretty quickly into my main line. And even with c4 here, black is pretty stable. Yeah, but that was a completely different opening. Different setup. So the thing is, against the standard Scandinavian, I can't play like I do in the gambits. Yeah, knight c3 is basically this. to work against the d4 line. Yeah, I know. Yeah, I need to look at that again. It's a line that I haven't really looked into for a very long time, and I have to do that because there are so many good players who, yeah. But like I said, you played a very good game, so I can't complain about getting a worse position when I'm not quite sure about what to do in the position, and then you just basically killed me. Acer bait. Yeah, I always forget I have e5 in this position. And basically, if he takes, I take back, and he takes, then I go here, check, takes, and check, and grab this guy. And if he tries something like this, then pain will follow. And this is not exactly what what black wants in this position. Yeah, in this position I should have played knight b5 immediately, because d6 is so weak now. Yeah, that would have been a really nasty line, you know. And it would have been the same if you had taken with the bishop first. E6 is a blunder due to this little move here. You don't really want my knight to come in here, but you can't really do anything about it. Because if the bishop goes back, then my bishop comes out here. Hey, thank you for the bits there, Gina. For the 100 centis. So knight f6, knight d6, king f8. Yeah, castle short, knight takes e4, knight takes, center fork trick. Yeah, even in this position, black is quite a lot better. No, white is quite a lot better if we turn on the engine here. Yeah, a pawn and a half, give or take. And the position is so open, and my rooks will be coming onto the open files very quickly. Yeah, okay, now it's just plus 2.7, so it's just getting better and better. Just take here. Yeah, this will swing back and forth for a long time. And of course the engine is a scumbag, so it doesn't really tell you too much. So, knight there was no good. Just allowing me to trade. Yeah, this turned out to be, yeah, I should have backed off, just keep the pin. I was thinking about that, but I wasn't really happy about this particular possibility. But there is no good way of kicking my bishop away from there. Because then I have this going to kick this bishop away, and then this comes in. I missed that. this was quite scary for a bit, but then everything sort of started to work out for me. Don't know why this is supposed to be a weak move, because this is always coming. Don't know why the engine doesn't like it straight away. Of course, the engine wants me to go there to take away the development of the bishop, but I had other ideas. And there. Yeah, I thought G4 was crazy enough. Yeah, thanks, man. Bishop E3 turns out to be a blunder, and Bishop E5 as well. Okay. Then you took the rook. And then you blundered this. And this is basically where the game was lost in the end, mainly due to the sack I had on c8. And there, suddenly up a knight and a bishop, and all you had was just grabbing a pawn, and then it was just finished. Yeah, trading the queens was the worst thing you could have done. You really need to get the queen out of the way. Could have checked me here just to get the queen out of dodge. I probably would have blocked with my queen or my knight. Doesn't matter really which one. But then of course my queen is going to swing over to harass you on this side. So the last game was DK guy, and I'm quite surprised that I was doing okay for the first 18 moves or so, or even longer. Yeah, he had one blunder, I had two. What in the world is Rook A6 here? How much worse is it if he takes here? Down the exchange there. But I'm still winning. Yeah, because I have this. And he is in a pretty dire straits. Yeah, you turned around, there were no men left. King completely bare bone. Yeah, king here. Yeah, take with a pawn. Forcing this side. And then this. Going to be pretty painful for DK guy if he had gone down that line. There, there, there. I probably would have. Nah, I couldn't go there. Yeah, this side. The king comes out. And then the bishop. Damn, this is brutal. Oh, you want? Yeah, I think that's the best move here. Forcing to take. And then just rip away the queen. Typical engine I know. But I was just looking at this engine line after rook a6, if you would just grab the guy there. But then the engine just turns it around and points to something else. In this position, King F1. Yeah, but I blundered with Bishop D7, and you were suddenly up a full minor piece. So this is basically where I stumbled over myself. And this is considered a blunder. Okay, I did find the best move. The thing is, the engine is looking at all kinds of calculations, maybe 10 to 15 moves ahead. That's why you shouldn't pay too much attention to the engine, Jela. Yeah. Taking here, yeah, still in this position you had this, and that was kind of hard to survive. And I did see this. I was just waiting for a moment when it would work. Maybe a rook c1 would work, I don't know. Just hitting this guy again, but you always have this. And I have to defend that. Yeah, the thing is, humans, the very best of them, the super grandmasters, they can maybe calculate very long lines. But for regular guys like me, I can maybe calculate 3, 4, 5 moves ahead. On a very good day, if it's a forced line, maybe 8 to 9. But guys like, but they are often, the tactics that the engine finds are not very simple. Yeah. So this was basically me being dead, but after he went this way, A4, not the best move, fortunately for me. Hey, Jacob, welcome, man. Yeah, thank you, man. Thank you. Yeah, I did stream my unfortunate loss. Yeah, the super teams only calculate like 4 to 5 moves ahead in most positions because there are so many things they have to take into consideration, you know. Yeah, good point, there's a bit. Yeah, then I had a quick simul and won two games pretty resoundingly, had one loss due to being just completely crushed, and the last game I was losing, but Gina fell just flagged. Yeah, they know which moves to omit from their calculations, so that's a big thing. You really need to know that. Okay, I made a mistake of playing g5, which basically puts me on the back foot straight away. And from that point on, it was just a matter of Yeah, I went wrong side, and then of course he just infiltrated and shit was just gone. Yeah, they know what to omit from the calculations. And so this was the death of me in the simul. But yeah, one game I did not deserve to win. The others were more. But there was one game I played earlier. Actually, two games I played earlier today. I want to show you guys those games. First was this one here. Amora. And I asked Mark Esserman to look at it. Yeah, good night, man. Thank you for dropping by. And in this position, Mark told me Rook E1 is the move. I went down a tempo with what I was planning, and my opponent, he didn't really find the right continuation. So I decided to go there, he went there. So I'm suddenly one move back, because usually in this position, this bishop is sitting there. No, I was white. Yeah, the thing is, I'm aiming for knight d5 in this position. And that is when the knight, if we back up a little bit, if black had gone, let's go to the analysis board here. If we back up one move, for both, let's see, in this position here, if you had gone here, which is the line Van Veli played against against Mark Esserman, then you go for this, Van Veli did this, and then he backed off to here, and as soon as this happened, boom, and takes, knight d5, d6. And basically, this is a horrible position for black. This bishop is cutting through, and the king is completely stuck in the middle. And if I remember correctly, Esserman, yeah, it was this particular game, so we opened that up in this position. I can show you how that game went. Bishop b7, knight takes, pawn takes, f4. This is a blunder by a super grandmaster, because he was almost 2,700 federated at the time of the game. At the time of this game, Mark was exactly 800 FIDE rating points ahead of where I am now. Bishop g5, and this is a nasty little trap. This is a nasty little trap. Yeah, absolutely brutal. So he had to go for this. Check. Check. Knight takes. Queen e2. And the threat is to go there, there, and there. So he immediately went there. Check. He goes there. And now this move comes very difficult thing to deal with. Queen d6. This is an absolutely brutal thing. King d8, rook takes, and then queen takes. To add insult to injury. And this is where he resigned, actually. It was a complete destruction. But in my game, I went down as a tempo and turned out that my idea wasn't really the best. But this is suddenly where I grabbed hold of the game again. King ran away and grabbed that thing. Then traded there. Kick off this guy, check him. I don't know why the engine doesn't like this much, but well, all kinds of crazy stuff that happened there. But this was a pretty brutal game, and my opponent, he just basically played himself into mate. Well, not mate, but he resigned there. Yeah, I never got to d6, unfortunately, because he didn't take my knight. And the other game I wanted to show you guys, I had this guy who decided to play the French defense against me. And I enjoy playing the King's Indian attack against those. And he played a very freaky setup. I've never seen this before. With b5 there, I have no idea what he was trying to do. Some kind of a light square clamp, and then he suddenly break it apart. This is a very weird way to play, I think. And then he suddenly opens up his queen side, and I suddenly get this opening here. Yeah, he didn't really want me to go there. I was actually pondering f4 here. Mainly because he doesn't really have a good way of stopping the infiltration going out here eventually. Because I could have gone just down there and then the bishop out. Yeah, I didn't really want to play a4 this early in it. And I was down a lot on the clock by there. At least at the end. So we traded there. This is where I made a nasty blunder. I should have played bishop to a5. I missed it. Yeah, very strange prey upon moves, because he weakened the dark square so much on the queen side, and I just missed this perfect opportunity to take advantage of it. Skewering this, and I don't know how he would have dealt with it, to be honest. Yeah, he could have done rook takes rook, and but according to the engine, that's no good, really. But I don't know. I'm not an engine. So I decided to dive in there and Yeah, often it's that way. Like having my queen here on this diagonal, he can't castle, so he is stuck. Yeah. So he decided to go there, and then I went for this. And I gave up my bishop. Yeah, bishop c8 looked scary, and I decided just to get the hell out of Dodge. So I decided to reroute my knights. And when he made this move, I think he was more or less lost. Giving me that pawn. And this was no good either. And then he blundered this and completely destroyed himself. And then I just sacked the exchange and mated him on the spot. So he caused his own downfall. So this was a fun mate. And the thing is, he thought for almost 30 seconds on this particular move. Yeah, but I didn't play all my games that well. I played one move in between those two and completely had my ass kicked. Deservedly so, because I wasn't playing the best. Yeah, but I have to call it a night, guys. Are you streaming now, Jacob, or later? So who can I raid? Let's take a look. Go to the other computer here and jump into... Yeah, you're welcome, Jella. Absolutely welcome. Let's see. Good to think to have another laptop sitting on the side here. Yeah, thank you guys. Yeah, thanks, man. So I think we maybe just raid Dennis. We'll raid Dennis. So that will be interesting to see what he's up to. So, thank you all for joining me, and very thankful for the raids by Pascal, aka Sludgy, and Asilius. So, see you around, guys, and for the next stream, who knows, might be this weekend. So, good night. Nice.